सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरि ॐ तत्सत्. सो यस्टर्डे वी हैड स्टॉप्ड विद द डेफिनेशन ऑफ what is a sutra, that's where we had stopped. What's a sutra? So what is a sutra? What is the definition of a sutra?
Yes, I haven't memorized it, but alpa aksharam asindam sarva vishva tomukham asto bhamana vadam cha sutram sutra vidha.
Actually, it is
many mistakes.
Alpaksharam, alpaksharam, asandigdam,
asandigdam,
asandigdam, sandigda. In many languages, in Hindi and Bengali also, you have the same word. Sandigda means doubtful. Asandigdam, asandigdam, saravat vishvatomukham, asthobam. अस्थोभम अनवद्यम च सूत्रम सूत्रविदो जना विदुहु सूत्रम सूत्रविदो विदुहु. द मीनिंग इज अल्पाक्षरम, दैट इज विच हैज द लीस्ट नंबर ऑफ लेटर्स और लेस नंबर ऑफ लेटर्स, एंड असंदिग्धम विच इज विदाउट डाउट, एंड सारवत विच इज समरी, बट एट द सेम टाइम विश्वतो मुखम, इट कंटेन्स द नॉलेज ऑफ द एंटायर वर्ल्ड. अस्थोभम which is without a pause or stop, without break. Anavadyam, and which is faultless. And that is called sutram according to sutravid. Those who know about sutra, they say that this is sutra. Now, you see, about Brahma Sutras, what we first discussed, why the Brahma Sutras are necessary, why you need to study Brahma Sutras, because to get a clearer conception of the fact that this whole world is nothing but Brahman, this entire universe is nothing but Brahman, to get that clearly, to have a firm conviction about that, we have to study Brahma Sutras. And also the other reason why we study Brahma Sutras is to attain realization. But how can you study something and attain realization? So, no, you cannot study something and attain realization, but by studying this, the ignorance, which is in fact preventing you from understanding your true knowledge self, will go away. So, the knowledge is not brought, but ignorance is removed. And that ignorance is removed by creating a counter kind of idea, producing a counter to this ignorance. Like in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, it is told that when you have a bad thought, or when you have a troublesome thought, when your mind is being disturbed, then you have to create a counter thought. So when somebody is depressed or something, we create a positive thought, we give some pep talk, etc. And if your pep talk is not good, the person may commit suicide. But if it is good, that person may come out of depression. And so that is called Pratipaksha Bhavana in Patanjali Yoga Sutras. The same idea is maintained here, that when we consider ourselves to be limited, when we consider ourselves to be this body and mind, if we have to understand our true reality, that is, we are not this body and the mind, but we are Sat, absolute existence, Chit, absolute consciousness or knowledge, and Ananda, bliss. If we have to understand that, then constantly there has to be something called Jnanakara Vritti. That means a vritti or a thought or an impression which is in the form of knowledge, or Brahmakara Vritti. So vritti or thought itself is illusory. It is part of mind which itself is unreal, but that has to be created so that this goes away. Just like when you have a bad smell coming somewhere, either you find out the source of the smell and you remove it. If there is a rat which is dead, you remove the rat and you throw the rat, or if it's a lizard, you throw it and clean it and the smell goes away. But what if the smell is coming from such a source which you have no control upon? So what you can do is, you can maybe light an incense stick, or maybe have a room spray or something. And then you can prevent the bad smell by causing more damage. So similarly, we have to develop this Brahmakara Vritti. That is the impression, the thought that what is your true nature. And to do that, we have to study the Upanishads in detail. In fact, we have to do a thorough analysis of the Upanishads, and we have to read those statements which are called Mahavakyas. Mahavakyas means any sentence which tells you the identity of Brahman and Jiva is called Mahavakyas. Jiva Brahma Aikya Pratipadaka Vakyam Mahavakyam. So this Mahavakyas, whenever you have to study them properly, you have to understand them properly, then you have to study them from all their dimensions. And so Brahma Sutras, some scholars say that Brahma Sutras is actually a compendium, it's a collection, it's a compilation of whatever knowledge was available on Vedanta. So whatever kind of decisions people arrived at, scholars arrived at, or practitioners arrived at, based on the Upanishadic statements, they were all compiled in one text, and that text is called Brahma Sutras. This is not the majority opinion, but some people have this opinion. And some people say that, you see, I told you yesterday that there are six Indian philosophies which follow the Vedas, that means Vedic schools of philosophy, and in that the fifth one is Purva Mimamsa, which was started by Jaimini. Now some people believe that Jaimini, he made a set of sutras based on the Samaveda, and he called them sutras. And so they say that maybe this Brahma Sutra could have been influenced by those sutras. And also such scholars says that though these sutras were made or written by Jaimini, first two sutras of those Jaimini's Brahma Sutras are the same as the Brahma Sutras of Vedanta, which have been attributed to somebody called Badarayana Vyasa, which again leads to a lot of confusion. We will just have a glimpse about that confusion. Now, these Brahma Sutras are what we are talking about. Jaimini has written something called Mimamsa Sutras, that is there. But we are talking about Vedanta Sutras. So why would Jaimini write Vedanta Sutras? We don't know. But it is an opinion that there is a reference, or there are some references to texts written by Jaimini apart from Mimamsa Sutras. And so they could be like Brahma Sutras, and they have the text, and in which the first two sutras are the same as the present Brahma Sutras. Now again, this is a questionable thing. We don't know. But some other scholars say that this Vedanta Sutra, Brahma Sutras are called Vedanta Sutras also. They are called Brahma Sutras, they are called Vedanta Sutras, they are called Siddhanta Sutras, they are also called Shariraka Sutras. Shariraka Sutras. So there are so many names given to this Brahma Sutra. Siddhanta Sutras, because the Siddhanta, or the conclusion of Vedanta, is based on this. Okay, so that is why it is told Siddhanta Sutras. And Sharirika Sutras, why? Because that which is embodied, that is found in these sutras, or the embodied is discussed in these sutras. Embodied is the Atman. Because of ignorance, we consider the Atman to be embodied. Atman is not actually embodied, but that is what is talked about in the sutras. So, Sharirika Sutras. Sharirika means one who has, who possesses Sharira, or one who possesses the body. Now, Chandogya Brahma Sutra and Brihadaranyaka Brahma Sutra, there were two Brahma Sutras which were present, or which have been found by researchers. They are called Chandogya Brahma Sutra, Brihadaranyaka Brahma Sutra. And so again, that is also a questionable thing. And some people also say that, you see, it is a fashion almost nowadays to question anything which is Indian. So just because it is from India, it is all cock and bull story. So similarly, some people have said that Brahma Sutra itself is an edited thing, that such thing never existed, or this is all a later extrapolation, etc., etc. Now, Badarayana Vyasa, who is considered to be the author of the Brahma Sutras, who has written these 555 sutras in four chapters, that person, whether he was Krishna Dvaipayana Vyasa, whether he was the same person who wrote the Bhagavata, who wrote the Puranas, who classified the Vedas, and who wrote the Mahabharata, that's a big question. So now we can say that he was not. Many people say that he was not the same person. This is a different person altogether. But then we find Shankaracharya's commentary, and also the commentaries on Brahma Sutra by the followers of Shankaracharya. Like, there is the famous commentary by a person called Vachaspati Mishra. It is called Bhamati. And there is a commentary by Shankaracharya's direct disciple Padmapada, which is called Panchapadika. Now, the beauty with Indian studies, even scholarly studies, is that every study comes with a lot of rich wealth of lores or legends or stories. So, in fact, it is not so difficult to approach any scriptural text within the broad structure of Hinduism, because all these texts come with a lot of stories. So I told you Panchapadika, it has a story, Bhamati has a story, etc., etc. We will see all those studies. Then there is something called Vivarana Prameya Sangraha, which is also a kind of gloss on the Gita, kind of explanation, of the Brahma Sutras. And you have something called Chitsukhi, which is also another gloss or tika on the Brahma Sutra. So when we go through all these texts, we find that all of them, even Anandagiri's tika on Brahma Sutras, which is called, on the Shankaracharya's commentary on Brahma Sutras, which is called Nyaya Nirnaya. So that also, they all unanimously credit Vyasa to be the author of Brahma Sutras. So that is one thing. Second thing is, in Panini, in 43110 of Panini, that is Ashtadhyayi of Panini. In that 43110, there is a sutra, a Panini Ashtadhyayi. If you don't know already, I can tell you the Panini Ashtadhyayi is, you don't know, you have not studied it probably, but what is it? It is a compendium, it is a work on Sanskrit grammar. I mean, it is the ultimate Bible of Sanskrit grammar. It is called Ashtadhyayi, so it is very simple that it has got 8 chapters. And it is written by Panini, and there is a Bhashya on that. There is a commentary on this by Patanjali. Now, this Panini's 43110, there comes a sutra which is called Bhikshu Sutra Natayoho. So what does it mean? It means that a grammar point is being explained there, and there it is told that, just like Bhikshu Sutra, what is that? That the sutra is written for bhikshus. So here, obviously, Brahma Sutras are being referred to. Now, that means Brahma Sutras are meant to be read by the bhikshus, by mendicants, by monks and nuns. Bhikshu can include bhikshuni. In fact, there is a famous, it's not famous, but there is a law which talks about how to interpret acts in India. The different acts are there to how to interpret acts. So in that law, there is one section where it says he means he includes she. Okay, so bhikshu can include bhikshuni. Now that means it was meant for mendicants and nuns and monks and nuns. What does that mean? Does that mean that householders cannot study Brahma Sutras? Could that be the meaning? So the idea is, no, that is not the meaning. But the idea is that householders, where would they get so much time to study Brahma Sutras? Now, of course, because of technology and so many other things, we have so much time to do WhatsApp, etc. So instead of doing that, we study Brahma Sutras. That's okay. Now, in the modern context, it all makes sense. But in the olden days, when the householder had to do a lot of physical activity also, where would the householder get time to study a text in such detail? And to study the Brahma Sutras, of course, again, the kind of study we do today is also not even 1% of what they used to do in those days. For example, to study Brahma Sutras, you should have studied all the other five systems of philosophy in the original. Sure. So, Sankhya, we don't get the entire original of Sankhya Sutras, but whatever we get, that you should have studied. Then you should have studied Yoga Sutras in detail. Then you should have studied Nyaya Sutra, Vaisheshika Sutras, then Mimamsa Sutras. Then you can come. Why? Because in Brahma Sutras, all these texts are referred to. All these texts are referred to. But now what do? We take a English translation of all this and say, okay. So, but you not understand the implication or the true position of the respective sutras or respective texts which are going to be referred in this Brahma Sutras. So we will try to see that when we come across a particular reference, we will try to go into detail why this is told, etc. But the idea is, where will householders get so much time? So that is why
they might be, I was saying, they might do it in their mind. Say, for example, they can take up one sutra and then throughout the day, like, memorize it and think through it.
It's not just about memorizing or something. You see, what happens is, in the olden days, people did not even talk about memory, because memorizing was not even talked about, because though there were elaborate systems of memorization, like there was something called Ghanapata, Kramapata, Padapata, they used to repeat the same mantra in various ways so that they can memorize it. Though all these systems were in place, but we don't see people memorizing things and all that. Why? I doubt whether they had to-do lists those days, because their memory was quite strong. So here the question is not about memorizing, but here the question is about going into the intricacies and nuances of all these texts. And the references and the cross references, and also what is now called as the intertextuality. Like, what is a particular sutra telling, which it is not actually telling. So the hidden message, etc., etc. Then to find out the context. So all these things cannot be just done mentally. You have to sit down and you have to do a deep study of the thing. So maybe for that purpose, Brahma Sutras were not, and even today, Brahma Sutras are not popularly taught to householders. It is basically a text which is studied by mendicants or monks, or which is studied more, I would say, by philosophers in the academia, because they have to make something to make money. So as Shankaracharya says, udara nimittam bahukrita vesham, for the sake of stomach, you put on many guises, disguises, so they do all these things. But the idea is that Brahma Sutras basically are such a polemical text that it is not possible for householders to discuss this. And in the Gita we see, Rishibhir Bahudha Gitam Chandobhir Vividhai Prathak Brahma Sutra Padaishchaiva Hetumad Bihi Vinirshitam. So in that also, we see that Brahma Sutras are talked about. Brahma Sutras are talked about in the Gita, which comes in the Mahabharata. So that means Brahma Sutras have to be necessarily before Mahabharata. Because how can Mahabharata talk about Brahma Sutra? And if Vyasa is talking about Brahma Sutras in Mahabharata, so this Vyasa cannot be later than Mahabharata's Vyasa. At least he will be the same Vyasa, or he will be before him. So we can safely conclude that they are the same person. That is the idea. In Brahma Sutra, about Brahma Sutra, while commenting on this particular shloka in the Gita, which is the 13th chapter, which comes in the 13th chapter, it is the 4th shloka. It is the 4th shloka. And it is the 5th shloka. Fourth shloka. Here, here Shankaracharya in the commentary says, commentary on this particular Bhagavadgita shloka, which is 13th chapter, 4th shloka. He says, Brahmani suchakani vakyani, Brahma sutrani, taihi padyate nyayate brahma iti padani, iti eva madibihi brahma sutra padaihi atma nyayate. So, brahma brahmani suchakani vakyani brahma sutrani. So brahmani suchakani vakyani brahma sutrani. That means brahma sutras are sentences which tell us about, or which suchaka indicate about Brahman. Brahma, so Gambhiranji translates it as, Brahma Sutras are the sentences indicative of Brahman. Okay. And they are called as Padani. They are called Brahma Sutra, or they are called Padani. Padani means, already he said Brahma Sutra, they are called Padani means, there you can say Brahma Sutra Padaishchaiva. In the Gita, it is told, Brahma Sutra Padaishchaiva. So this word Pada has been used for Sutra. So that could be a question. Why did they use this word Pada for Sutra? Because Sutra is different, Pada is different, Gadya is different. Okay. So why it is told? Because by that, Taihi, through them, Padyate Jnayate Brahma. Brahman is padyate. Padyate means the meaning is given, synonym is given by Shankaracharya, nyayate. Through them, padyate reached. Brahman is reached, that means nyayate, is known. Through them, Brahman is padyate, reached or known. And so, padanim padani iti eva madibihi. So, they are called padani. Okay. And Brahma Sutra Padaihi Atma Gyayate. The idea is that the self is known through Brahma Sutra. Atma is known. Atman is known through self, Brahma Sutra. So it's very important that we understand this. And with this perspective, with this ethos or bhava, we study the text. So the study of Brahma Sutra should not be done with an aim of attaining scholarship, though as I told you, many people do that in the academia particularly, but that is not the goal of the text. The goal of the text is Atma, Atma Jnana, Brahma Sutra Padaihi, that means through Brahma Sutras, Atma or Atman is known. So we have to consider this. So every time the question should not be objective, but the question should be subjective, that how can this particular sutra or how can this particular analysis help me in my understanding that I am not different from Brahman. This has to be constantly, at every step of the study of Brahma Sutra, we have to constantly think. And so that is why, you see, when you say trigonometry formula, that means what? By knowing these formulae, you can solve trigonometry problems. When we say differentiation or integration in calculus, differential calculus, integral calculus, when we say the principles, etc. So by these, following these principles, we will be able to tackle the problems which we come across in calculus. Similarly, for many other things, when you have a recipe, you can cook this, provided you switch on the stove, etc. So that kind of thing we have. So when we say that they are God formulas, or this is my coinage, that means that by using this formula, you can attain God. It should mean that, right? Otherwise, yeah. It doesn't make any sense. So using these formulas, you should be able to attain God. So that is why Brahma Sutras are sutras which will enable you to realize Brahman. So this will lead to the knowledge of Brahman. How will it lead to the knowledge of Brahman? This will not lead to the knowledge of Brahman, but this will lead to the destruction of ignorance or ajnana or avidya. Now you see, there was a person called Upavarsha. Now do you want those stories now or later on?
Yeah, you can tell. I like okay. Stories.
So who does not like stories? Anyway, so there is this story, you see. This you might have even seen in the film, in the movie on Shankaracharya. Have you seen the movie on Shankaracharya? Sanskrit
no.
Movie. You should
no.
See, it's available on the YouTube. It was done by a person called G.V. Iyer, who completely botched up the movie on Swamiji. But this movie was well done. Anyway, so he later on did a movie on, I think, Ramanuja, Madhvacharya. So in that movie, this incident is there. Padmapada was a disciple of Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya had four disciples. Who were they?
I don't know.
Mandana Mishra was one person who later on became Sureshwaracharya, and then Padmapadacharya, then Hastamalaka, then Totakacharya. There were four disciples were there. So this Padmapada, he was very scholarly and all that, and very intelligent, of course. And so he wanted, when he read the Brahma Sutras, commentary on the Brahma Sutras of Shankaracharya, Shankaracharya's commentary on Brahma Sutras, he wanted to write a gloss, tika, on that commentary. So what is a tika? It takes the commentary and word by word explains the commentary. Okay, that's okay. A tika. It's called a gloss. So it follows the commentary. He wanted to do that. And so he wrote a text. Okay. And then he gave it to Shankaracharya for reading it. And Shankaracharya, it seems, was reading it. And I don't know. There are various accounts of this story, but one account is that the most popular account is that he was reading it and he was sitting by the ocean, and so all this palm leaf or whatever it would have been those days, and he was just sitting like that, and all the manuscript went away. It was swept away by the ocean. So maybe he went into samadhi, or God knows what happened. But this is probably, he went into some trance or samadhi, and so this went away, and then he was all sad that, oh, this is all lost. And so Shankaracharya then remembered that, no, I have read so much. So he had read five chapters. Okay. So five he had read, and so five he remembered, because as soon as he read something, he was remembering. Seeing something, he was remembering. So Shruti Dhara means once you hear or once you see or read, you remember. So he said, I will write it. I will write and give it to you. And so he wrote it and gave it to Padmapada. And that is called Panchapadika. Means that which has got only five parts. Okay. This is one story. Second story is about how Vachaspati Mishra wrote his gloss on Brahma Sutra. So Vachaspati Mishra is an interesting person. He is called Sarva Tantra Swatantra. Tantra means philosophy. So a person who is free from all philosophies. That means he has written commentaries on all philosophies, all six Vedic philosophies he has written. But he was himself a Advaita Vedanti. So though he wrote commentaries on all other five philosophies, he was not influenced by them. So Sarva Tantra Swatantra, he was independent of all the philosophies. And so he was writing his famous commentary, which is called Bhamati, and he was writing it. It seems he wrote it for 20 years and then he used to not think of anything else. I don't know exactly the logistics, but this is the story that he used to write and write and write, and he used to eat and then again write and all that. Then after 20 years, when he finished it, he just lifted his head up and he saw a lady standing. And he asked him, "Who are you?" And that lady said that, "I am your wife." So, "Oh, acha, you are my wife." So this person was totally forgetful. He forgot everything. He was so immersed in that work that he forgot everything. They said, "Oh, you are my wife. Okay. So, So he said, "Yes, didn't you know that I was kindling your lamp and I was maintaining your lamp and I was cleaning the place and I was giving you food, etc., etc." So he said, "Okay, what is your name?" "Bhamati." So he named that whole work after her. Now these are the two stories. Anyway, we will, as we move along, we will have our own share of stories. So the idea is, now there was a person called Upavarsha. Okay. And he wrote a gloss. There are different kinds of glosses. So one gloss is called Vritti, which does not exactly follow the commentary. So that Vritti is called Krita Koti, and it was written somewhere in 500 BCE, that means before Christian era, that means. And also at that same time, Bodhayana was also there, who was another person, scholar. Now there is again this controversy whether they are all the same person, whether Upavarsha and Bodhayana are same. Some people say, no, Upavarsha followed Advaita Vedanta, whereas Bodhayana followed Vishishta Advaita. But you see, there is a big text which is not talked of even in academic circles, means it is talked of very, very less. What is the text? It is called Katha Sarit Sagara. What is that? It is supposed to have 10,000 stories. How do the stories operate? There is one story within which there is another story, within which there is another story, like that it goes on till 5,000, and from there they start coming back from the previous story, previous story. So there was a person called Somadatta. He wrote this marvelous work and in Sanskrit. And there we find that Upavarsha has been talked of to be the guru of Panini of the Sanskrit grammar. So if Upavarsha was guru of Panini, that means we can conclude that he was someone different from Bodhayana, like that. Now you see, Shankaracharya himself has become kind of mythological figure, because the historicity of, or the exact date, not historicity, but the exact date and the other particulars of Shankaracharya are quite, fuzzy. We are not very clear about these things. But the popular account, or the majority account of people, majority of academics or scholars agree upon a period, which is 788 to 820 Christian era. Now that is 32 years, because according to all accounts available, Shankaracharya lived only up to 32 years. Originally he was supposed to live only for 16 years. He got some bonus boon, etc. All these stories are there. Now, but some authors or some scholars, they say, no, that is not, that is too late, because we find the influence of Shankaracharya's works in other authors before that. So how can it be that Shankaracharya came after them? So 655 to 688 CE, Christian era, is the correct time. Whatever that may be, we need not bother about this, because Shankaracharya, such a huge brain or such a huge intellect, though Swami Vivekananda sometimes critiques Shankaracharya, when comparing him with Buddha, he says Shankara had the intellect but Buddha had the heart. Means Shankara's intellect, heart did not come anywhere closer to Buddha's heart. Though we do see Shankara being magnanimous in his lifetime, but still his heart was not more pronounced, his intellect was more pronounced. Whereas in the case of Buddha, it doesn't mean that Lord Buddha was not intelligent. He was, of course, but he was having a profound mind. But then he, in his life, we see heart being more pronounced, predominant. So this Shankaracharya, with such an intellect, he has given solid arguments and solid rationale for Advaita Vedanta. And he has given us beautiful poetry. And even his prose, that is commentary, is in such simple language. The Sanskrit of Shankaracharya is most simple. Anybody who has even a smattering of Sanskrit can understand, or people who know, Indian languages can understand, because most of the words are all very common words. He does not flaunt his scholarship, which we see in later authors. People make it all complicated and show that they know the language. But Shankaracharya's language is very simple, and he has given us so many hymns and so much of poetry. So whether Shankaracharya was there or not becomes a secondary or even a tertiary question. As Swamiji would say, that whether Krishna was a historical person is not necessary, because the Krishna who gave Gita, even though there might not have been a person who was there who was called Krishna, but at least someone thought of the Gita, and in somebody's mind this magnificent text came, took birth. So we consider that person as Krishna. That is the logic Swamiji gives. So somebody might have thought. Similarly, we don't know when Shankaracharya lived and the exact nitty-gritties of his life, but we do know that there are so many texts which have been attributed to him and which are unanimously. There are some texts where the authorship is contested, but numerous texts, means majority texts, only 3-4 works authorship is contested. Otherwise, all texts are attributed to Shankaracharya. So whoever this Shankaracharya, Acharya Shankara or Adi Shankaracharya would have been, that person was a great mind. That is the idea. Now, you can take mythology and you can say that he was Shiva's avatar and all that. I don't think, as I told you, our study should be not objective but subjective. So whether he was Shiva's avatara or whether he was God himself or whatever he was, how does that help me in my spiritual life? Or how does that help me reduce my suffering? It does not. So we better leave it at that. We are not going into that kind of discussion. Now, you see, Vedanta is also called Uttaramimamsa. Oh my God. Already 40 minutes. So, okay, see, when a person who is in the habit of speaking starts speaking, then...
You can continue. I don't have any problem.
No. You don't have any problem. I just let a pause. So, do you have any questions till now?
No. So far, I understood.
So far, you're safe. So... So, you see, Uttara Mimamsa, Vedanta is called Uttara Mimamsa, and there is something called Purva Mimamsa. So, Mimamsa philosophy is called Purva Mimamsa. Now, why this word Mimamsa? Mimamsa means analysis. It can also mean measurement, but it means analysis. Generally, it means analysis. In Hindi also use the word Mimamsa. In Bengali also this word is there, Mimamsa. In many other Indian languages it is there. So, ki mimamsa hoyeche, for example, in Bengali they say, what mimamsa has happened? That means mimamsa ki hoyeche means what? That doesn't mean what happened to the philosophy, but it means what decision did it come to, or what did you finally decide, etc., etc. So an analysis of a subject, that's called Mimamsa. So here a subject can be analyzed. What will you analyze it for? To what end? What is the goal of analysis? So you see, like a physicist will say, I analyze the physical world to find out the true nature of the physical world. I analyze to find out what is it that keeps the physical world going. What is it at the substratum or at the background behind the curtain story of the physical world. And so they say, now we want to find out one force which will explain the basic three forces. Earlier it was four forces, three forces, etc. If you ask a biologist, she or he will say, oh, my analysis is to find out how things function, how life forms function, how they create their life systems and how they survive. So I just want to study this, analyze this. Why? To gain inputs on the way they function so that we can understand things about evolution, etc. If you ask a doctor who is into treating patients, that what do you analyze? So the doctor basically analyzes, when studying, analyzes how the body functions, or rather how it functions in a normal scenario, so that when that person and she or he meets a patient, she or he can clearly say that this patient has this problem because of this particular function not happening properly. You see, so the doctor sees analysis in two ways. One is analysis of a normal human being and analysis of a patient, which we call as diagnosis. But when we are talking about philosophy, what is it that philosophy wants? Why philosophize?
To remove the ignorance so that we can perceive God, like, without any time-space limitation.
Yeah, so here when you say this, you already presume that all philosophers want to realize God. It's a very blanket presumption, and it's a blanket conclusion, which is not true, because all philosophers don't want God. So, you see, but philosophy, all philosophy, they want to bring clarity. So the goal of philosophy, why philosophize? To bring clarity. See, the goal of why critical thought? To bring clarity. So the goal of philosophy is not to, may not be always to see God. It depends on the philosopher. And if he talks too much of God, he will turn into a theologian. So there also, there is a lot of, you see, Ranganathanji was very fond of quotation. He used to say that, Swami Ranganathanji used to say that there were, you know, two people and who were fighting about a black cat in a dark room. So there was a black cat, and it was in a dark room. So a person says that I have seen a black cat in a dark room, or he talks about the black cat in a dark room. Philosopher, he talks about, or she or he talks about, a black cat in a dark room. But the theologian is a person who claims to have found it. So theologian says that no, I have found. So the whole thing is confusion, because black cat in a dark room, how will you know? But the philosopher is talking about that, but the theologian is cocksure. He says, no, I have found it. So this I know, I have found it. So that would happen. But philosophy in itself, philosophy as a discipline, the goal of philosophical exercises or philosophical discourses or critical thought, as we say, is to bring clarity. So Mimamsa means basically philosophical analysis. Okay. And the goal of this kind of analysis is to remove three things. What are they? Samshaya, doubt. Goal is to remove three things. Samshaya, doubt. Then asambhavana, impossibility. Then viparita bhavana, wrong understanding. So first is doubt, then impossibility, then wrong understanding. So if you don't know clearly about something, it will create confusion. If you think that something which is never possible is possible, that again will create confusion. And if you wrongly understand something, that again will create confusion. This we can see in any aspect of our life. So these are the three things which Mimamsa or philosophical analysis aims to bring, remove, eliminate. Sanshaya, Asambhavana and Viparita Bhavana. Now Vedanta Uttara Mimamsa, Purva Mimamsa. Purva Mimamsa tries to do this analysis using Dharma. That means using a life structured pattern of life where you actually try to live and get things for your sustenance based on a disciplined manner. But so if you want, for example, if you want, say somebody wants an offspring, so they do a sacrifice to get that offspring. And so many things are, they are all very scientifically done. There is this nature is taken care of, environment is taken care of, the wildlife or the animal life is taken care of, flora, fauna, they are taken care of. All these things are taken care of because there are sacrifices for rains, etc. So if by doing that sacrifice rain came, that means there should have been some connection. You see, even now people do that sacrifice and rain comes. Even now in India, many states, this is done. So that means just because by doing a sacrifice rain comes, we cannot simply say that, oh, this is all kind of hogwash, it doesn't happen. Just because we don't know, we cannot say it doesn't happen. Sure. Our ignorance cannot deny a possibility, you see. You have to understand that. Mm-hmm. I will give you an example. I am fond of this, which I read long ago in Reader's Digest. You know, in Reader's Digest, they give humor in uniform, lives like that, etc., etc. Nowadays, the quality, once Reader's Digest got an Indian version, it has come down a lot. But earlier, it was good. So, now, one person, car service engineer, to be specific, it was Ford. He was working in Ford and he just joined the job. He was just appointed and he got a, he got a call. In fact, she came, an old lady came. She was totally upset and she came with her car. And she said that I am upset and I want some redressal. I want my complaint to be attended to. So he said, why didn't you call? She said, I have been calling for several months and people only make fun of me and nobody is attending to my complaint. So what is your complaint? He says, you see, I have this car. I take this car and go to the, you know, this ice cream vendor. Means you drive in and you just don't drop. You just by the counter, you can get it, right? You also would have gone to such places. So, yeah. So you go to the window and you take. So I go to the ice cream place and when I order vanilla, my car is okay. It's idling. When I order vanilla, my car is okay. But when I order chocolate, my car stops. Okay. So he said, what kind of complaint is, what has ice cream to do with car? Like car doesn't know whether you're ordering vanilla or you're ordering chocolate. So he also first smiled or something and then the lady said, you see, that's what I was talking about. Everyone is simply, when I tell this, everyone says, okay, okay, and something, they keep the phone down. And so nobody has attended and for several months I have this problem. So this, because he was just new and he had this enthusiasm and all that, so he thought that, okay, let us go and see. So I said, do you mind if I come with you? He said, yes. Okay, so they went with the car. And she went to the place and he said, now you order vanilla. And so they ordered vanilla and it was idling, nothing happened, and then again they went back, drove a little, and then again they came, and then this time they ordered chocolate. And as she said, correct, that as soon as she ordered chocolate, by the time chocolate came, the vehicle stopped. So, because he was an engineer, he tried to find out what is the automobile part here. And then he understood that vanilla took maybe only 1 minute or 2 minutes, but chocolate took 10 minutes or something like that, 5 minutes or something more than that. Because chocolate is not something which people order often. So, vanilla they had ready, always they have ready. So, idling time was when it was 1 or 2 minutes, then the car did not stop. But when it became more than 5 minutes, car stopped. So now he brought it into his equation and he could solve the problem, which was just an air block or something. The idea is, on the face of it, you may not understand why it is happening. But when you bring the particular variables in place, then you can immediately understand, oh, this is why it is happening. But the person is not, the person who is complaining may not be a specialist. Most often is not a specialist. And so that person will not know why this is happening. So similar the case with all these sacrifices. Even today, there are numerous reports of people doing such sacrifices and getting the results. So that means there is something which we are missing. We have lost that knowledge, or we don't have the patience to do thorough research on that. But whatever, the goal of Mimamsa Darshana or Mimamsa philosophy was to create such a life structure where everything will be attained in a syncretic fashion, means in a, the word which we are so fond of these days, holistic fashion. So nothing would be deprived, or rather another word which we are fond of is sustainable manner. So you have anything, you have any seminar, all you have to do is add these high sounding words and everybody is, wow, what a wonderful talk it was. So anyway, so that sustainable thing they did, and this was to attain dharma. And Uttara Mimamsa or Vedanta, the goal was to attain Brahman. How to attain Brahman? Okay, or you can say that Purva Mimamsa concentrated on the karma kanda, ritual part of the Vedas, which is found in the Brahmanas. And Uttara Mimamsa concentrates on the Jnana Kanda or the knowledge portion of the Vedas, which is generally found in the Aranyakas or the Upanishad. And so that is why you will find that they are two analyses, but in different directions. Two inquiries in different directions. And that is why you will find that the Mimamsa Sutras, they start with the first sutra of Mimamsa Sutras is Athato Dharma Jignyasa. So here an inquiry into dharma begins. Atha means before this so many things have been told. Ataha means now. So after this means after you have become qualified for studying, now dharma jigyasa, an inquiry into dharma is begun. And in Vedanta Sutras or Brahma Sutras, we say atha to brahma jigyasa. Now an inquiry into Brahman is started. So the goal is different, but if we think about the bigger plan of this scheme, then we understand that unless you have your life in proper place, you cannot actually think beyond life. So realizing Brahman is in a manner thinking beyond life. You are not just thinking about the body and mind. You are thinking beyond your body and mind. So moksha, which is called liberation, which is realizing Brahman or realizing God, that is the goal of life. But that is supported by dharma also. So do you have any questions till now?
No.
So how is this going? I mean, this is going a bit it'll go a little more. Is it not boring? Is it becoming boring?
No, not at all. Very interesting. Very. Actually, I wanted to tell you, like on Thursday also, I will make it. So I will reschedule my meeting. So apart from Wednesday, we can do it every day.
Okay. So. Okay. So that is good. So because it will take time, we will go into each and every You see, even before that, these things need to be told to you so that you get an idea of what is what. Now you see, Shankaracharya, this person, he could have told that Brahman is there and this is how you should realize Brahman. Instead of just doing that, he brought something called Maya. Of course, these are not names of people, Maya, Vidya and all that. They are all concepts. So, Maya, now Maya, what does Maya mean? What does Maya mean?
So, world not properly understood is Maya. Like if we take the apparent reality and think it to be real, that is Maya.
No, why? Apparent reality in itself is also Maya.
Yes, yes. Like if we take that for real, like if we take it too serious.
Even if you take it for real, even then it is Maya.
No, I mean, take it in the sense, we don't see God behind it, then it is Maya. Like we don't see God's place.
See, the apparent reality, no. The apparent reality is that, it is apparent reality.
Yes,
even though if you believe it to be true, even if you believe it to untrue, even if you know that it is unreal, it is apparent reality, and that is Maya. That's why Swamiji in one of his Jnana Yoga lectures, he says Maya is a statement of facts. He tells it quite a number of times in that lecture. Maya is a statement of facts. So what you see is Maya. You may know that it is apparent only, it is not real. You may not know that. Either way, it is Maya. It's not Maya only because the meaning in which you are using this term is how it is used in many Indian languages, including Hindi. So, sab Maya hai, everything is Maya, etc. Maya moh mein fas gaya, he got caught up in Maya, etc. So, actually that is not exactly correct philosophically speaking, because all of us are caught up in the Maya moh.
Yeah.
All of us are caught up in the snares of Maya. So, that the idea is that though you think it is unreal or though you think it is real, it is Maya nonetheless. So, why was this Maya necessary? You see, Maya is just a concept. There is no reality to Maya. Maya means the difficulty in explaining the apparent. That is why this word was used. How do you explain the apparent? I know that there is only one reality. Fine. I know that that reality is beyond time, space and causation. Means that reality is not bound in time, space and causation. Fine. Okay. So logically I have proven that. If all this is true, why does this happen? Why are you born? Why do you see so many things? Shankaracharya also saw these things. So why does that happen to begin with? And that is Maya. So that is why Swamiji very nicely put it as statement of facts. Means you cannot say that Duryodhana asked this question. He says, I know what is correct, I know what is wrong, but I cannot help it. Like he says, Janami dharmam nachame pravrittim, janami adharmam nachame nivrittim. I know what is dharma, but I cannot do it. And I know what is adharma, but I cannot stop doing it. So that means Maya is something which is difficult to explain. And so in Viveka Chudamani, Shankaracharya himself says that it is you cannot say it is not there, but at the same time you cannot say it is there. And it is all anirvachaniya, that is the word he uses. That means inexplicable, which cannot be explained. Vachaniya means that which can be put into words, which can be described. So anirvachaniya means it cannot be described, indescribable or inexplicable, which cannot be explained. So that is Maya. So how did the one become the many? That is the question.
Sure.
And the answer is we don't know. We simply don't know. And so we cannot all the time say we don't know. And so we have conveniently put some words like Maya, Avidya, Ajnana, etc., which means illusion or ignorance, etc. But again, you cannot just say Maya is illusion, because you do experience it. See, right. Maya is not something like the example is given, flower in sky, Akasha Kusuma, which can never happen, which is an impossibility. Maya is not an impossibility because it does happen. When you see when you mistake the coil rope to be snake, you start sweating and the sweat is very much real. The palpitation is very much real. You cannot simply say, no, there was no palpitation, there was no sweat. It is there. And even when you get the knowledge that it is rope, not snake, maybe sweat has not dried or palpitation has not stopped. So this is what Maya is. Okay. And we explain, how did the one become many? It's because of Maya, because of Maya, because of avidya, because of ignorance. Because of ignorance. Recently, I read Nivedita saying in a place, very nicely she is putting it. She's saying that, you see, this one and many, this concept, Shankaracharya says that the one is real and the many is unreal. Shankaracharya says that the one is real and the many is unreal. And she, before Shankaracharya, she puts somebody's, I forgot, I think Krishna or somebody. And then she says, but Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda, they say that this one and the many are both coming from the same source. So she put it very, very poignantly. She put it poignantly. So that particular quotation is wonderful. The idea is yeah. Shankaracharya said that the many is unreal and the one is real. But Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda, they say that this one and many, they are all coming from the same source. That is why Brahma Satya Jagat Satya, that is what Swami Turiyananda said before he passed away. So that we have to understand. I think I read it in, I don't remember where I read it. I think I read it in the Aggressive Hinduism, the book Aggressive Hinduism. I think I read it there. And Nivedita is also very powerful when she summarizes the philosophy of Swami Vivekananda. In fact, if you want to understand Swami Vivekananda's philosophy, two people you should read. One is Nivedita, another one is Aurobindo.
Okay.
Aurobindo has gone to lengths explaining Karma Yoga, Raja Yoga and Jnana Yoga. But you see, just by telling that there is Maya does not solve the problem. You've just given a name. Just like you go to a doctor and the doctor says, oh, you have got myocardial infarction. That person died. Simple heart attack, myocardial infarction. Something they say like that, no? And you are like, what happened? Conjunctivitis. You will say, "Arey, ye to Jai Bangla." Says, "Oh, you have got conjunctivitis." So something very common thing they will make so complicated, but that doesn't solve it. You have to actually treat it. So there is an adage or there is a maxim in Sanskrit which says, "Bhakshite api lashune na vyadi shanti." That means you ask me to eat lashuna, means lesun or garlic. Garlic has many medicinal properties. So I ate it regularly. All I got is maybe I started belching, but nothing happened. Means my disease did not get cured. So postulating a concept or saying that it is Maya or avidya or ignorance doesn't help. How do we get out of it?
Right.
And so that is the whole object of studying the Upanishads in detail, and so that is what we will be doing in the Brahma Sutras study. Okay. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat.